There's a place that shapes almost every semiconductor technology. A place that's 3 to 4 generations ahead. But I'm not talking about San Francisco, the Silicon Valley, or Taiwan. I'm talking about a small Belgian town you probably never heard of. And more specifically, a company that was founded there over 40 years ago. Let me tell you the story of how a tiny nonprofit company from a small Belgian town became the world's largest research and innovation center for the semiconductor industry, and how today it shapes almost every single next generation technology. The semiconductor industry is the most complex and complicated industry in the world. Turning sand into thinking machines is an almost impossible feat. And yet every year microchips get smaller and more sophisticated. But that's not coincidence, nor is it something one company alone can achieve. That's where imec comes in. Originally the Intel University Microelectronics Center, but today imec is much more than that. imec has become a sort of town hall for the semiconductor industry, a place where the entire industry comes together to figure out how to make the impossible possible. It's quite literally where next generation technologies are born. High-NA EUV, the imec research lab is literally inside ASML's workshop. New memory technology, no matter if next-gen eDRAM or MRAM, imec is your one-stop shop. Silicon photonics, that's so 2025. imec is already working on photonics-based interposers. And while we are hyped for 3-nanometer nodes, the researchers at imec are fully focused on nodes well beyond 2 nanometers, including next-gen transistors like CFETs. But how did they get there? How did a non-profit from Belgium of all places become such an important central hub for the semiconductor industry? Well, if you ask me, there's one simple answer. FABs, FABs, and even more FABs. This is the imec HQ in Leuven, Belgium. At first glance, it looks like a standard office complex, but that couldn't be further from the truth. Hidden behind these walls are some of the most advanced clean rooms in the world. I'm talking 300mm wafers with all the fab equipment you could think of, including multiple EUV scanners. And preparation for the addition of a next-gen High-NA EUV scanner are already underway, which means reinforcing the clean room floors so they can withstand the immense weight of the $400 million machine. The imec campus at Leuven contains 4 fabs or clean rooms, plus multiple highly specialized labs. imec's unique selling point is that they not only have the brains, in the form of over 6,000 scientists and engineers, but they also have the brawn. And by that, I mean the capacity to manufacture leading-edge nodes. Other research institutes might have some form of R&D production, but they pale in comparison to the state-of-the-art clean rooms that imec owns and operates. We're literally talking about billions of dollars in equipment. Of course, it wasn't always like this. It started in 1986, only 2 years after imec was founded, with the opening of a 3,500 square meter clean room and a 125mm wafer line that allowed imec to manufacture 1.25 micron small CMOS structures. Not only a good process node for the time, but a capability that put them on the map. Soon, other microchip companies started to work with imec in order to take advantage of the production and thus R&D capabilities imec offered. Because just like today, in 1986 it was a very special capability that not many companies had access to. And imec noticed that. Semiconductor fabrication is very expensive, more so now than in the 1980s, but even back then the tools and equipment needed quickly ran into the millions. And being a non-profit, imec didn't really have the means. But the local Flemish and the Belgian government took a bet and invested the majority of the public's innovation fund into a single company, imec. And that bet paid off. In the following years, imec rapidly advanced its semiconductor capabilities, sometimes even starting to lead the industry in the adoption of larger wafers and advanced process nodes. 150mm wafer capability was introduced in 1994, and only 5 years later, in 1999, a 200mm wafer pilot line was added. By 2005, imec already used 300mm wafers, which has been a standard ever since. imec was also at the forefront when the industry contemplated switching to even larger 450mm wafers. Now, it's important to understand that when we are talking about production capacity, we aren't talking about high volume manufacturing. imec is not a fab like TSMC or GlobalFoundries. And imec, the clean rooms are used for R&D purposes. but they do have all the fancy equipment like a state-of-the-art fab would. And often they even get the tools early because the tools manufacturer themselves are doing their R&D at imec too. This creates an environment that facilitates innovation. This past May, just before the yearly imec technology forum, ITF for short, I was lucky enough to visit the imec HQ in Leuven, get a tour of one of the clean rooms and speak to some of the imec experts about their research. During this visit, I also got to see slides with other companies that currently do research at and with imec. And while I'm not allowed to show these slides, what struck me was that literally the entire industry is working with imec. I honestly can't say why those slides are confidential, because basically every semiconductor company I've ever heard of is an imec partner, plus plenty of companies I've never heard of too. The research done at imec covers the entire supply chain. Of course, you have the equipment manufacturers. They use imec to make sure everything works in a clean room environment and with other tools. It's no secret that ASML has a long-standing history with imec. Then you have the material suppliers and system partners. Chemicals, lenses, lasers, mirrors, all chip design houses, electronic design automation developers, and much more. There's a reason Apple's Johnny Cerucci got an award at this year's ITF, and last year AMD CEO Lisa Su was there, because they all work with imec. New transistor shapes? imec is leading the research. A new standard for wafer masks? You probably have to do it at imec. Where else could you get the entire supply chain to come together? If 450mm wafers will ever make a comeback, which they won't, it would probably be at imec. I've never met so many smart people doing research on next-gen semiconductor technology in one place as in Leuven and later in Antwerp at the ITF event. Which is strange, because for how important imec is, they are still rather unknown. I've heard of imec only a few years ago, and I'm very involved in semiconductors. Maybe it's because they are a non-profit company, and you as a consumer can't really buy anything from imec, or maybe because they are more in the background with their R&D. In any case, if you work in the industry or have any interest in semiconductors at all, you should know about imec. So how does the imec system work? Can you just go there, use their research capabilities and clean rooms? Well, no. imec is a bit like a country club. It comes with a buy-in price. imec is still a non-profit company, and there's no indication it would join OpenAI and become a for-profit company in the future. A big chunk of imec's money thus comes from public grants like the Belgian government or the European Union. The EU actually allocated about 2 billion euros to a new nano IC pilot line that focuses on beyond 2 nanometer process nodes and other next-gen technology. But even 2 billion euros is very little when it comes to state-of-the-art semiconductor tech. That's why a majority of imec's funding is provided by their research partners and technologies that imec licenses to the industry. Companies can buy their way into the imec club by providing goods like multi-million dollar fab equipment or with plain old cash. Many of the first machines in the clean room at Leuven that I got to visit were a gift from Intel back in 2005 to get a new pilot line going. These endowments, in combination with the public grants, allow imec to keep up with such a fast-moving industry. And it enables imec to continue, with their partners, the amazing research into technologies that we will hopefully benefit from in the next 5 to 10 years. And because I started this channel to talk about exciting new tech, let's take a closer look at a technology that will not only shape how process nodes advance beyond 2 nanometers, but a technology where imec plays a fundamental part in the development. High-NA EUV. The term numerical aperture describes the light-gathering properties of a lens or an optical system. The key advantage of a higher numerical aperture is that you can gather more light. High-NA EUV, as the name implies, is EUV lithography with a higher numerical aperture. It can gather more light. Current low-NA EUV machines have a numerical aperture of 0.33, while High-NA increases that to 0.55. imec and its partners have worked on High-NA for well over a decade now. And the most obvious tell of how important imec is the fact that when ASML built its first High-NA EUV scanners, they basically turned the very production hall into an imec research lab, around the machines at the ASML factory. It doesn't get more involved than that. Of course, at some point, ASML would like the space back because they needed to ramp up the production, but that's another story. There are plenty of engineering challenges when it comes to High-NA. If you are interested in a deep dive into the technology, I highly recommend Asianometry. John made some amazing videos on the topic. They are worth a watch, just like all his other videos. But there are two specific aspects I want to cover. It was a real eye-opener for me when I talked to an imec engineer who worked on High-NA from the very beginning, because it made me realize the insane engineering behind this technology. Sometimes all you need is a smart person who takes the time to explain complicated things to you. It can be so easy. The first aspect that I want to cover is that High-NA EUV requires an anamorphic lens. But why is that? And most importantly, what is that? Let's start from the beginning. High-NA EUV isn't a new technology, it's an evolution. As such, there are parts of the scanner that don't change when going from low to High-NA. And there are parts that change a lot. The power source, for example, stays pretty much the same. But the illumination system and the projection objects, basically a collection of massive mirrors that focus the extreme ultraviolet light, first onto the mask and then from the mask to the wafer, are reaching never seen before dimensions. The weight of just this part alone increases 4 times over low NA, to about 6 tons. I'm not an optics expert and all of this is a bit over my head, but this massive new illumination system introduces problems with the angle at which the light hits the mask and the angle the light is reflected back from the mask, because in EUV system, the mask is a mirror. The light isn't shining through the mask, it's reflected by it. With low NA, the angles still worked out. You could shine the light onto the mask and the return wouldn't influence it. But with the larger mirrors of a high-NA system, the light starts to interfere with each other, meaning incoming and outgoing light would get in each other's way. The solution is an anamorphic lens. Anamorphic means that the magnification of the mask, basically how the light is returned from the mask and projected onto the wafer, has different scaling factors on the X and Y axis. With low-NA, the XY scaling factor is symmetrical. The light hits the reticle mask, which has a size of 104 by 132 mm, and scales it by a factor of 4 in both dimensions. So the projection optics of the EUV scanner, that's the part that comes after the light has hit the mask, turns 104 by 132 mm into 26 by 32 mm. That's the scaling factor. That's also why the current reticle limit, basically how large a single chip can be, is 26 by 33 millimeters. With High-NA, the scaling factor on the x-axis stays the same at 4, while the scaling factor on the y-axis is increased to 8. That's the anamorphic lens system. And because the size of the reticle mask doesn't change with High-NA, it's still 104 by 132 millimeters, the reticle size for High-NA is now 26 by 16.5 millimeters. Because 104 millimeters divided by 4 is still 26, but 132 mm divided by 8 is 16.5. As a result, the current low NA reticle limit of 858 square millimeters is cut in half to only 429 square millimeters. And all of that because the mirrors needed to reach a numerical aperture of 0.55 are so big they get in each other's way. Talk about a bummer. This reduction in reticle size will have a few interesting implications. For once, chiplets will become a necessity because large chips aren't possible anymore, at least not without die stitching. And I'm not only talking about massive AI chips, even GB202, the chip powering the RTX 5090, would be too big. And secondly, die stitching, which is basically overlapping patterns to create a larger chip, will see a massive increase in interest, and we will see a lot of improvements over the coming decade. Anamorphic scaling will also greatly increase the importance of computational lithography, because calculating the mask gets that much more complicated. The second aspect I wanted to touch on is depth of focus. We all know depth of focus from when we take a picture. With a wide focus range, everything in the picture is sharp, from the objects in the front of the picture to the very back. But when you work with a shallow depth of focus, only some objects are in focus. The rest of the image becomes blurry. It's the same with High-NA. But instead of meters or maybe centimeters, we are talking about nanometers, maybe a few dozen. Not only is that an absolute tiny depth of focus, it creates completely new challenges. All of the parts that go into or interact with a EUV scanner are precisely engineered. The wafers are super flat and polished, the masks are immaculate, or so it seems. But when your depth of focus is measured in nanometers, suddenly nothing can be perfect enough. What seemed like a perfectly flat wafer in a low NA machine suddenly looks more like a mountain range. A single imperfection, just a few nanometers in size and height, suddenly pushes the resist you want to hit out of focus. And it's a similar problem with the photomasks. A single nanometer deviation means that the light suddenly doesn't hit what it's supposed to. The light just isn't in focus anymore. As a result, with High-NA EUV, everything has to become super flat. Something I didn't realize before, but when you think about it, makes a lot of sense. My takeaway from High-NA is that there isn't a singular challenge. It's more a collection of many small quirks and features that need to be adjusted in order for High-NA to work. And it will work. We just have to wait a few more years. 2028 is my guess. And the research done at imec plays a major part in that. There are many more technologies I would love to cover. I was lucky to get to talk with so many smart people of imec that I could basically continue for hours. I'm especially excited about next-gen memory technologies like a resurgence of eDRAM with a special twist, or new MRAM technology. And the future of silicon photonics looks super interesting. Prototype photonics-based interposers actually already exist, and I talked to the people who designed them. But these are topics for another video. One question I get asked quite often is where to start if you are interested in semiconductors. Maybe you are still studying, maybe you just finished, or you are already working in the industry. Everyone knows about ASML, TSMC, NVIDIA and so on. But I think a better answer would be to take a look at imec. It's what we in Germany would call a hidden champion. imec isn't just in Belgium, they have a global presence. A new Fab 5 is under construction in Malaga, Spain. And there are research locations all over the world, including Japan, Taiwan, the US, India, and much more. And imec covers literally all aspects of semiconductors. Where else could you work on next-gen technology with almost the entire industry as a partner? Who knows, maybe I will talk to one of you guys during an upcoming visit to imec, where you explain to me how next-gen semiconductors work. That would be pretty cool. I hope you enjoyed this video, and see you in the next one.